Wings and Co.'s third case, The Vanishing of Billy Buckle, written by Sally Gardner and read by Simon Russell Beale. Chapter 1. The renowned fairy detective agency Wings & Co. had a problem. Really quite a big problem. In fact, you could say it had a ginormous problem. The giant Billy Buckle had vanished, and if that wasn't big enough, he had left his six-year-old daughter Primrose in the care of the detectives, Fidget the Cat, Emily Vole, and Buster Ignatius Spicer. The trouble was that Primrose, being a giant's daughter, was growing a little taller every day. Unless the three detectives found Billy Buckle and soon, she would be too big to go in and out of the shop. But as Emily knew from past cases, nothing to do with fairy folk, be they witches, elves, goblins, or giants, was going to be simple. Emily Vole, the keeper of the keys, had inherited Wings & Co. from Miss String, an enchanting old lady who had lived next door to Emily's dreadful adoptive parents, the Dashwoods. It was Miss String who had saved her from being their unpaid servant-stroke-nanny. She had taught Emily to read and write, and much more besides. During their first case together, Fidget and Emily had found the famous fairy detective, Buster Ignatius Spicer, shrunk to the size of a doll and locked in a birdcage by a goblin. Emily had bought the birdcage and freed Buster, but he still felt that A, Emily shouldn't have inherited the detective agency, and B, Emily shouldn't have become keeper of the keys. She wasn't a fairy, and by rights, it should have been his job. He was a proper fairy, born and bred. But perhaps the real reason Buster was permanently grumpy was that he had been 11 for 100 years, and the only thing he didn't know about being 11 was how to become 12. Then there was Fidget. Emily could imagine many things, but never life without dear Fidget. He was a handsome, long-haired tortoiseshell cat, 190 centimetres tall, who'd been a builder for a magician until the witch Harpella had turned him into a cat. And there they all were, with one ginormous problem. It had started one wet Monday when Fidget told Emily that his old mate, the giant Billy Buckle, needed someone to look after his daughter Primrose for a weekend. "Why?" said Emily. So many strange things had happened since Emily had first met Fidget that the idea he knew a giant didn't strike her as all that odd.
"Because he plays the bassoon in the Sad Dad's band and they're having a reunion gig."
"Why couldn't he take his daughter with him?" Emily had asked.
"Because of the bog-eyed loader," replied Fidget.
"The bog-eyed loader?" repeated Emily.
"Yeah, he lives in a cave in the Valley of Doom," said Fidget.
Fidget was seated in his favourite armchair, knitting a cotton fish-shaped hat, while outside the rain poured. It was not, Emily thought, much of a summer.
"I've never heard of it. Is it near Podgy Bottom?" she asked.
"Frazzle of Fishmonger is nowhere near here. It's in the land of the giants," said Fidget.
"How is it that you know Billy Buckle?" asked Emily.
"Billy was a great friend of Miss String," said Fidget.
Anything to do with the late Miss Otterline String always had Emily's full attention. Fidget and Miss String had first met Billy Buckle many moons ago when the fairy detectives were investigating the case of the missing harp. After that, the giant had often visited them for tea until he'd moved away.
"He did?" said Emily, impressed.
She tried to imagine a giant sitting in one of Miss String's deck chairs and drinking tea out of an impossibly small teacup.
"Where did he move to?"
"We never knew, my little ducks," said Fidget. "That's the thing with giants. They have very long legs. Anyway, now, out of the blue, I've heard from him."
"How?"
"There is a postal service," said Fidget.
"You mean letters? With stamps? Not email?"
"Well, not stamps, exactly. Not email, exactly. Sometimes, my little ducks," said Fidget kindly, I have to pinch myself and remember you are not a fairy.
Oh, dear, said Emily. I wish I was. It might make things easier. For a start, Buster wouldn't be so horrible to me.
Never mind, said Fidget. I wouldn't change a squid about you.
What exactly is a bog-eyed loader? Asked Emily.
He's an ogre, most of the time, and fierce to boot, with a nasty habit of shape-shifting.
Oh, said Emily. Like turning into a hippopotamus?
Yeah, that sort of thing.
Or a fish?
If he did that, said Fidget, I would sardine tin him straight away.
A twitchy look came over Fidget's whiskers, which usually meant he felt he'd answered enough questions. Emily was determined to find out more before Fidget went off in search of fish paste sandwiches. So that's why Billy Buckle isn't taking his daughter.
Spot on the Fishcake, said Fidget. The bog-eyed loader has been known to take travellers prisoner. Once he caught a wizard's wife and wouldn't let her go until the wizard agreed to teach the bog-eyed loader some spells. A magic spell in the hands of the bog-eyed loader is a very dangerous thing indeed. There is no knowing what he might do with it.
Emily had wanted to ask why Primrose couldn't stay with her mum if the Valley of Doom was so unsafe, and about what else a bog-eyed loader could do, but she saw that Fidget was lost in fishy dreams. He wandered off, muttering to himself about fish-paste sandwiches. She had tried to find out more about the ogre from Buster. He was sprawled on his bed looking at a magazine. He glanced up at Emily.
Do you think my clothes look a bit old-fashioned? He said. Has the time come for a revamp?
What do you know about the bog-eyed loader? Emily asked.
Don't go saying his name round here. It isn't lucky, said Buster.
Why not?
Asked Emily. Because he can foggle a fairy.
Foggle?
Oh, said Buster. Yet another of the many things you don't know about fairies. You do know that bats make a high-pitched noise that echoes back at them so they can find their way in the dark.
Yes, said Emily, I do, actually. She was rather interested in bats.
Well, fairies have the same sort of thing, and the bog-eyed loader can foggle it up, which isn't good.
You mean the fairies bang into things and can't find their way around? But by now Buster was bored with the subject.
Look at these trainers, he said. They're well wicked. They're gold ones and silver ones, even trainers with flashing lights. I think I would look super cool in those.
Emily sighed. Why wouldn't anyone tell her more about the bog-eyed loader? He sounded interesting. And since they had solved the case of the three pickled herrings, not much that was interesting had happened. Life had settled down to a sleepy pace. The weather had become warmer, the trees had turned green, and Buster went out flying. A lot. The magic lamp, which had once belonged to the witch Harpella, but had since turned over a new leaf, now spent hours in front of the mirror shining itself and encouraging the keys to have a better hygiene program. Emily sometimes wondered if the title Keeper of the Keys shouldn't belong to the magic lamp rather than her, for the keys never did a thing she asked them to do, like opening drawers in the curious cabinets and returning wings to their rightful owners. They only seemed to listen to the lamp and followed it around wherever it went. As for Donut, the miniature Dachshund, who had adopted the detectives during the case of the three pickled herrings, he slept most of the day or waited to be taken for a walk. Fidget sat knitting more and more fish scarves, hats, gloves and jumpers. He'd even knitted a dress for Emily that had ended up in the shape of a fish. Emily was very proud of it and wore it quite often. The most exciting event in ages was the arrival of Billy Buckle and Primrose. They had turned up one muggy July evening 2 weeks earlier. Emily's first glimpse of Billy had been a pair of very large red shoes at the shop's entrance. Above them were striped socks and tartan trousers. Billy was the height of the second floor, and as for Primrose, she was only just able to squeeze through the shop door. Billy Buckle had crouched down to talk to Fidget.
It's very decent of you, dude, he said. The boys are right chuffed I'm going to be there. At last the sad dad's band will be back together again.
How long will you be gone? Fidget had asked.
Oh, a couple of days at the most. If it wasn't for the bog-eyed loader, I'd take my Primrose with me. But there you go. It just isn't safe. I can look after myself, but she's only a little thing.
He gave Primrose a kiss, told her to be good,
and went on his way. Since then, there'd been no sign of Billy Buckle. Fidget had made the usual inquiries, and letters had been exchanged with the other sad dads. All that anyone knew was that Billy Buckle had played two sets with the band before leaving to pick up Primrose. Fidget had even taken an ad in Fairy World International. It said simply that anyone with any information as to the whereabouts of Billy Buckle should contact Wings & Co. Emily had asked Fidget quietly if the bog-eyed loader could be responsible. More letters flew here and there.
"Definitely not," said Fidget. "Billy disappeared before he made it to the Valley of Doom."
Still, no one had replied to the ad. This, Emily had decided, was a case for Wings & Co.
And they needed to solve it quickly, for Primrose was growing daily.
Chapter 2. Unexpected things often happened at Wings & Co., but the shop was still able to spring a surprise. It had been built on four stout iron legs, and at the end of each leg there were three griffin's talons so that it could dig its way out of its foundations and go walking if it felt like it. Not that Emily had ever known it do so. Ever since she'd taken over the shop, it had stayed firmly in Podgy Bottom. That Wednesday morning, she woke to find the sun shining through her curtains, which in itself was strange, for not much sun ever came into the dark alleyway in Podgy Bottom, and never had she heard the sound of waves splashing outside her bedroom window. Emily leaped out of bed and pulled back her curtains to find the view completely changed. She was staring at a sea that sparkled with white-flecked waves. This was so unexpected that for a moment she couldn't believe her eyes. She closed her curtains again and, with butterflies fluttering in her tummy, opened them for the second time. The view was still the same. Just across the road there was a beach with donkeys and children with buckets and spades. Better still, Emily could see a pier with a big wheel on it. "Fidget!" she called as she opened her bedroom door. "Fidget!" She ran down the passage and collided with the cat.
"We've moved, my little ducks," said Fidget, lifting Emily off her feet and giving her a hug. "The old shop has decided to go walking."
He put Emily down.
"It seems it needed a bit of a holiday."
"Oh, yippee!" cried Emily.
She stopped.
"Oh, whoops! We have a case to solve, and I don't even know where we are."
Buster came sleepily out of his bedroom.
"There's a pair of eyes looking at me through the curtains, and those eyes weren't there last night."
"We've moved to the seaside," said Fidget.
"That still doesn't explain why two creepy eyes are looking in at me. Plus, there's a terrible noise coming from outside, a noise with screams attached."
The door on the landing flew open. The magic lamp marched out wearing a pair of sunglasses and an inflatable ring round its tummy. Behind it were the keys, all in a row.
"We are going to dip our toes in the sea,"
said the magic lamp with a skip and a hop.
"Hidey-ho, we are on holiday."
"Wait a mo," said Buster. "Salt water and an old brass lamp, isn't that a recipe for rust?"
"Don't try to be a cloud on my sunny day,"
said the lamp, walking towards the stairs, only to be sent spinning by Donut the dog, who had rushed up from the shop, wagging his tail.
"Oh, really?" said the magic lamp. "Why can't that dog ever look where he's going?"
"Come on," said Fidget. "Get dressed and let's find out where we are."
"Hold on a moment," said Emily. "Haven't we forgotten someone?"
"Who?" asked Buster.
"Primrose," said Emily.
"Badlier," said Fidget. "This puts a cod in the works. What are we going to do now?"
"What's the problem?" asked Buster.
"We need to find Billy Buckle and fast," said Emily. "That's the problem, remember? Primrose's dad is missing."
"Oh, that," sighed Buster. "Not much of an investigation for a detective such as I."
"In that case, why haven't you solved it?" asked Emily.
"Simply because there is nothing to solve," said Buster. "Billy Buckle met up with his chums and forgot the time. I bet he'll be back tomorrow, won't he, Fidget?" Fidget didn't look quite so sure.
"Hmm," he said.
"How will he find us?" said Emily. We have moved, if you haven't noticed.
Look, said Buster, this is no big deal. If I was Primrose's father, I would need more than a weekend away. I mean, I would need months and months and months away.
She's only six. I expect you were whiny when you were six, said Emily.
He was certainly grumpy, said Fidget.
No, I wasn't. I was charm itself. Anyway, I don't care how old she is. She's jolly irritating. That's all I'm saying. I bet you Billy Buckley is having a rot-rolling party somewhere.
Emily sighed. At times, working with Buster was most trying. The guest bedroom door opened, and there stood Primrose. She had a button nose and freckles, and her hair hung down in plaits. She was clinging to a sheepskin rug that she called Raggy. She was twice as tall as Emily and growing taller daily. Already, there'd be no end of problems on account of Primrose's size. She wasn't used to living over a small shop where she could bang her head on the ceiling, and Wings & Co. was so crammed full of bits and pieces that it was very hard indeed for her not to send something or other flying.
Where are we?
Asked Primrose, rubbing her eyes.
The shop felt in need of a holiday, said Fidget, and has taken a little walk.
Is that a good thing?
Asked Primrose.
Yes, said Fidget.
But how will my dad find us? Won't he go back to where he left me? And what then?
Said Primrose. Emily smiled weakly. Don't worry, Primrose, she said. We have everything under control. At that moment, the magic lamp came trotting back up the stairs from the front door.
My day is ruined! Ruined, I tell you. The front door won't open. I've pulled, I've pushed, and so have the keys. The shop has gone into lockdown.
The lamp stamped its little foot.
Why?
It said.
That's what I would like to know. Why?
So would I, thought Emily. Chapter 3 Edie Girdle closed her fortune-telling booth on the South Pier that afternoon and took herself off to the Starburst Ballroom. There, in its once grand surroundings, she and her friend Betty Sutton, the landlady of the Mermaid Hotel, regularly took part in the tea dance. It was the treat of their week to eat cakes and trip the light fantastic in their dancing shoes. Both ladies were striking. Edie Girdle was thin and tall with thick, unruly hair and a liking for colourful clothes and jangly earrings. Betty, on the other hand, was more refined in her taste, with neatly cropped hair and a penchant for cashmere and pearls. They'd been friends for as long as they could remember and had been going to the tea dance every Wednesday for the last 20 years. Since their husbands had passed away, they'd danced together.
Why should we stop? Betty always said. I mean, you have to have something to look forward to, don't you?
Edie couldn't have agreed more. The ballroom had a shiny wooden dance floor surrounded by little tables and chairs where tea was served to the dancers. At one end stood the stage with its red plush velvet curtains. They, like everything else, had seen better days. Nevertheless, Morris Flipwinkle sat happily playing the Starburst Ballroom's famous Wurlitzer. The organ, painted white and red, still sounded as good as the day it was built, back in the 1920s.
You know, Edie had once said to Betty, I hadn't a clue what a Wurlitzer was before I came to Pudley Pool on Sea. I mean, I thought it was a fairground ride, not an organ with buttons and pedals.
Eh, said Betty, you weren't far off the mark, love. It sounds to me like a merry-go-round playing the waltz.
It was after several whirls on the dance floor that they sat down to have their tea.
How are the bookings? We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.